Hello everyone. For today I'm going to talk about a new algorithm, a new unsymmetric pattern, a factorization that is based on UMFPACK. And this is the work done by with Dr. Davis. So this is a work in progress. We don't have a parallel algorithm yet, and it's about 5 years I'm working on this code. Most of ideas coming from UMFPACK. We also call UMFPACK for symbolic analysis, but you have a different code for the numerical computation. And our goal is to have a code suitable for parallelization on shared memory architectures like GPUs or OpenMP. So our method would be just like UMFPACK. It's a right-looking multifrontal method, and what we can use for our performance would be our dense blast kernels that can run very fast. So UMFPACK is a unsymmetric sparse LU factorization with unsymmetric pattern. This is a quite well-known algorithm. And it's a multifrontal method. With an unsymmetric pattern, when you have a multifrontal method, you have rectangular fronts. So, and sparsity is also important in pivot choice. What UMFPACK do is after each pivot, after finding each pivot, it updates the column and row degree, and then tries to find the sparsest pivot it can. And the design of UMFPACK is intrinsically very sequential. It uses data structures that it is very hard to make it, like change the code to make it parallel. The only way we could have is like designing a new algorithm. And UMFPACK has a very good performance in practice for a sequential algorithm. And it can use parallel blast kernels. So I had this talk on Seattle in this February. I'm showing the result that we had back then and the new development, the new things that we have to develop. In our symbolic analysis phase, we form a suitable elimination tree that comes from UMFPACK symbolic analysis. It permutes the matrix and post-order the tree. One thing that I added is I make an augmented tree. I will talk about that. It has some good characteristics adding to my algorithm, and especially with my new development that will have some interesting things that my algorithm can have a better performance. And I also compute the staircase structure. So when I make the pivotal columns, it has a staircase structure, so I can exploit those zeros. And also, I add some relax amalgamation in the symbolic analysis. These are not very new, but they have some impact in the future, our future development. I have already done them, and we are not going to make them parallel. Here is a diagram of a column elimination tree of an symbol. The thing is, when you are doing an unsymmetric pattern matrix, unlike a symmetric, you cannot take all the children. So it might, like, some part of the children can go to your ancestor. So basically, it is a DAG. And some methods have used DAGs to solve this problem. The augmented tree that I mentioned is basically, this is the original tree, and I look at the rows as prior contribution blocks. So I rename or recalculate some number for each each front in the original tree, and I can add the rows. So here, like, rows 8 to 9 is the children of front 10, basically. And so in this approach, each front have a set of rows that is consecutive numbers, and nobody else would touch them. That's a good characteristic for a parallel algorithm. Okay, let's talk about the fronts. What is now different with most multifrontal algorithms is the data structure that we have. We decided to have a very static data structure. At the time I was working on that, I was thinking about GPUs, but it can work also in CPU and OpenMP. So the symbolic analysis phase gave us the pivotal columns, and we have an upper bound on the number of contribution blocks of current front. We don't do anything with that, because we just know it. It comes. It's just like QR. But it can be very loose. So what we have, we know the number of pivotal columns, and then also what is different, we don't have any kind of permutations. Not like UMFPACK. So UMFPACK do permutation. We don't do that. What we do after we have the pivotal columns, we assemble the pivotal columns, and we know that they will have a circuit, which is a set basically. And we assemble them, we put the numbers there, and we start to factorize. What UMFPACK does after each pivot, after finding each pivot, it updates the row degree and column degree. We don't need the column degree, we don't do any column permutation, and we do a lazy update on the row degree. We do not update it after each pivot, we update it after each panel. So like for this chart, I have like the panel size 4, but in my code it's usually size 16. And so we have the circuit structure, we exploit those zeros, we find them, and we continue until the last pivot. There are a integer, and for the rest of the pivots, for the rest of this panel. And after the panel, we have the TRSM and DGEM and the row degree update after each panel. And so everything is done. We know the pivot, so we know the size of current front. We can take that, take this row structure, take the U part and the contribution block of the matrix. That is a very static. Like now, I know I can allocate the memory for that. And then we have this big TRSM and big DGEM. So we this can have a good performance from the blast parents. And this is when we allocate the memory. After that, we can also do the partial assembly from rows or columns, or if there's anything we can fully assemble. So this is the differences that we have with UMFPACK from the point of the front. This result I had in February. Let me explain this chart. The x-axis is the intensity. That is a good measure to show how hard is it to solve a matrix. That is number of flops per number of zeros from UMFPACK actually. If a matrix is here, it would be harder to solve. If it's here, it's like closer to them. And these three matrices are both, all of them are ratios of UMFPACK versus my code, my new code. And so here, the left one is the time ratio. So like here, my code is faster than UMFPACK. Here, my code is slower than UMFPACK. The thing I want to show you in this code is like, I was expecting to see a worse number non-zeros or worse number of flops, but I can see here, like for some matrices, for some not very hard matrices, I'm worse than UMFPACK. But as the matrix becomes bigger or harder to solve, I see better permutation. I couldn't explain it, but I still see it, and that's an interesting result. So since then, there were some problems that we have already fixed some of them. For parallelization, we can have a parallel parallelization among the fronts. And also that we could use the dense blast kernel. That's easy. We have already the parallel dense, and we can have different stages in parallelization. The challenges that we have, unlike UMFPACK, we are using tuples for rows and columns. I will explain them. The rows are independent. So any data structures that we have for rows, we can still use them. They're independent. Column tuples can be challenged in our design because there may be dependencies between columns. So we have to solve it somehow. We did that since February. And well, there are other problems in parallelization, like load balancing and other stuff that has been solved in literature. People have talked about it. So what is tuples? Tuples are two numbers in UMFPACK. That we have for each column and each row, we have a set of tuples. A number that shows which element is there, and also a number that shows the relative index of that element. For example, here we have column 84. And it has a tuple of 3 that shows the element 3 is there. And its fifth column is contributing to the column 84. So they are very effective. Basically, with passing through tuples of one front, you can see, you can compute the row degree, you can assemble them. They are very effective. And they're typically short. If the tuple is become long, that would be hard to go through and search through, and so that can cause some problems. For our case, when we start with a set of rows, the row list tuple is short. It can get long, but our column tuples could get very long, very big. And these tuples can use for assembly, degree update. They are very, very useful. So let me tell you what we done for this to solve it. We totally deleted the column tuples, and we are using some new solution to use instead of column tuples. What we do is sorting the columns of elements when we are making them, and also we keep the track of the least active column. For example, here we have this front and when we make it, we have this the list is sorted, so we can do binary search to find some column. And let's say there are some columns are eliminated from this front. We just flip that bit, so still we can do the binary search, and we keep track of the least active column. What it has, we can find the columns of the prior contribution block by binary search if we want, and also it has some good characteristics. So what we do is we keep a list of active descendant of each front in a mean heap based on the least active column. So when we are trying to assemble the pivotal columns, we just look at the mean heap and we take from the mean heap. And if the least active column is inside the pivotal columns that we need, we can take it and put it in the new list of pivotal columns, or we can stop. So it is an easy way of taking the pivotal columns. The other thing is, after making the current contribution block, we may need to search for for partial assembly or like full assembly. We need to find the columns. First of all, we can do the binary search on that because they are sorted. What other things I did is like making a hash of current contribution block. And try to first search in the hash. If I couldn't find it in the hash in a logarithmic time, I will do a binary search. So basically with that, we totally eliminated the column tuples from UMFPACK, from our new algorithm that is inherited from UMFPACK basically. And that hash can be really helpful. Let me add you some other points before. So
quickly, Mohsen, we're 15 minutes are up, but we'll let you continue for a couple of minutes.
I need 2 minutes, I think. So while we have still the row tuples, when we want to look at the prior contribution blocks, we can with just one pass through the row list, I can see it like these two upper contribution blocks are inside the current contribution block. So we know that. And what I did also, like this, the right down contribution blocks, I decided to punish it and see the result of the permutation And those, it seems that you can polish it and the quality of fermentation doesn't change that much. So yeah, then it's about how to, so in our new implementation, we have to compute this. We cannot by just going by, we have to compute the intersection of current contribution block to the prior. So it is like a set intersection. And sometimes we decide not to compute it and take an upper bound for it, so our algorithm can be faster. Here is our new results that we have. So the matrices come from pseudo sparse matrix collection, and it is I took all the matrices that have non-zero more than 10,000, and the pattern symmetry is less than 0.6. And now what I see, the algorithm changed a lot, my algorithm. Now it is a little, even like an average, I'm a little faster in my code. I also did that with more matrices. Still, it's about the same. And still, we have this characteristics of seeing that for and some a better non-number non-zeros and number of flops for bigger matrices than UMFPACK in my factorization. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Mohsen. Wrap it in. Thank you. We've got a couple of minutes just for questions. I don't see any coming over from YouTube. The main question I have is that, it's quite a challenge doing a parallel UMFPACK. I know that Tim has thought about it before, so it's good if you can help him out there. What's your target machine? I don't know if you mentioned that.
I was thinking about GPU, but it takes a long time to develop this code. So our next goal is to implement it probably in OpenMP. And with the result, it seems that we can have a very good implementation on OpenMP. Maybe after that, we go to a GPU. It is also because we have big blobs. I think that it can be a very good result in GPU too. So our first implementation would be an OpenMP, like shared memory, and then GPU.
Right.
Probably.
Okay. I think it's feasible. I was a bit worried you were looking straight at distributed memory machines, but you're looking at what we call single node performance, although the single node could be GPU or it could be a multi-core node or something. Yeah.
Exactly.